morning, Christ the King, and welcome to worship today. It is good to be together as we gather around sacred ritual, sacred word, and singing and celebrating the love and the grace of God in our lives today. Today, as we gather for worship, we have the privilege of hearing from Reverend Philip Knutson in South Africa. He will have a message for us here during worship, a greeting of hello and an update about what they are, how things are going in South Africa with the ministry that we support there. And he will also be joining us for our coffee hour at 11 a.m. today via Zoom. So we are grateful to have his presence with us, and we hope that you will be able to join us at 11. So that you can see him in real time and say hello to him and greet him. As we center ourselves in worship, this is my weekly opportunity to remind you that wherever you are right now is sacred. Whether you are on the couch, around the kitchen table, maybe you're in the car driving to work or to visit family, maybe to go get your COVID-19 test, maybe you are visiting with a parent or a friend. Maybe you are in the bathtub. Wherever you are right now is sacred space. God is present with you. And you are invited to center your heart and your mind in this time of worship. We begin our worship today with a time of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. I invite you to join me in our prayer. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ, through whom we have attained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. God of compassion, you have opened the way for us and brought us to yourself. Pour your love into our hearts, that overflowing with joy, we may freely share the blessing of your realm and faithfully proclaim the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Warm greetings to all from our family and your sisters and brothers in Southern Africa. We'd planned to be back in the U.S. this summer for the Summer Missionary Conference and to visit our sponsoring congregations. However, due to the COVID-19 pandemic and global travel restrictions, the ELCA Global Mission Office has canceled all home assignment visits for 2020. Lumri and I are well and staying in place under the nationwide lockdown, which started here in South Africa on March 27th. South Africa has recorded the highest number of confirmed COVID-19 cases among the 10 countries in the Southern Africa region. All of the countries have imposed various kinds of lockdowns, but are now looking at how to ease some of the restrictions, taking into account the need to curb the spread of the virus and to open up their struggling economies. Our companion churches in the region are sharing regular updates of how they are being affected by the pandemic and how they're responding. As social and church gatherings are restricted, pastors and congregations are using social media platforms like this to keep in touch, to share information, and present Sunday services, sermons, and devotions. As you know, this year, the gospel readings for each Sunday are mainly taken from Matthew's gospel. In story after dramatic story in Matthew's gospel, we see and learn how God's mission, how God's grace, comes into the world with great compassion to transform and heal broken relationships and to give hope and new life to all. Matthew's gospel culminates with the Great Commission in chapter 28, when Jesus sends the disciples out to make disciples, I like to say make missionaries, from all nations. But the previous chapters give the details of what this looks like. In my view, Matthew's gospel is a handbook for missionaries. In Matthew chapter 4, Jesus calls the first disciples, and in chapter 5, the Beatitudes, and in subsequent chapters, lays out the radical new vision of a different kind of world built on mercy, peace, and reconciliation, and justice for all, where there is enough to eat, a cup of cold water for the thirsty, forgiveness for sinners, and love for enemies. This vision is the basis for a joint message by the World Council of Churches, the Lutheran World Federation, the World Communion of Reformed Churches, and the Council for World Mission, entitled Economy of Life in a Time of Pandemic, which was issued in April 2020. It reads, the current COVID-19 pandemic has disrupted every aspect of our lives in a world already plagued with immense human suffering. The crises of the COVID-19 pandemic are rooted in human and systemic sickness. They stem from oppressive and exploitative economic systems that are based on the logic of profit-making, socioeconomic inequalities, ecological indifference, political self-interest, and colonial legacies. We're in the same storm, but we are not all in the same boat. COVID-19 is overshadowing many with fear, overturning their security, even undermining their faith. In this moment of crisis, we need a liberating theology coupled with a redemptive economy of life. This is a prophetic moment. As churches, we can see here a path towards the new creation. In Southern Africa, at this time, there is fear and deep concern, and there is faith, hope, and action. For example, Bishop Muniga of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Namibia wrote the following. We're terribly worried. If big and developed nations in the world are struggling, how will our small and poor Namibia cope and survive? Lord, have mercy on us. Pray with us and the whole world for the end of this pandemic. The Evangelical Lutheran Church Development Service in Malawi has drawn up a COVID-19 disaster response plan for the next 6 months, which is being supported with ELCA World Hunger Funds. The project works with communities to contain and manage the spread of the virus. The project will also improve the livelihoods of households by training them to produce and sell personal protective equipment, such as face masks, hand sanitizers, and hand washing equipment. As the ELCA, we are privileged to be able to walk with sisters and brothers in Southern Africa and to learn together what mission accompaniment means, to be called, gathered, and sent by grace alone to participate in God's mission of transformation, reconciliation, and mutual empowerment for the sake of the world. I like to say the church does not have a mission, rather God's mission has a church. It was and still is God's work, our hands. Thank you for your prayers and ongoing support for us as a family and for God's mission locally and globally. God bless you. Amen.
A reading from Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. Not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. Word of God, word of life.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Children's Sermon. Today, I thought that it would be the best time to talk about something that everybody all around us is kind of trying to figure out how to do. But God says that this is the most important thing that you need to do. This thing is to love your neighbor as yourself. And so today, in order to teach us about how to do this, I thought that we could read one of my favorite stories. Maybe I can love my neighbor too. So let's dive into this book and see what it says. Maybe I can love my neighbor too. Written by Jennifer Grant. Illustrated by Benjamin Shipper.
I live at the corner of 9th and 19th. Upstairs in apartment 4A. A building is going up across the street. Week after week, it grows taller and taller,
climbing up high in the sky. Mama, will all the new people be our neighbors too? I ask one day. Every single person is our neighbor, she says, whether they live next door or across the street or far, far away. I know I'm supposed to love my neighbors, but how can I love that many people? I ask. Mama gives me a hug. Oh, honey, she says, I'm sure you'll find a way. Maybe start by noticing the ways others show love. A man walks by the construction site, pushing a shopping cart that's stuffed with blankets and bags. The wheels hit a bump in the road, and the cart almost tips over. But one of the workers moves fast to catch it and sets it upright again. Helping someone who's just passing by is a way to show love. Maybe I can love my neighbor, too. Mama and I walk down to the park, just like we do every day. I see a man and a woman up ahead, talking to people while they wait at the light. I stare at the picture on the man's arms while he tells Mama about people who had to leave their homes because they weren't safe anymore. Mama hands a few dollars to the woman, who has a purple stripe in her hair. Giving money so people can have a safe place to live is a way to show love. Maybe I can love my neighbor too. At the park, an old man is shouting his dog's name. Shadow, Shadow, he calls. A boy runs after the dog, diving to catch him. A minute later, Shadow is back with his owner. The old man says, "Thank you," over and over and over. Helping older folks is a way to show love. Maybe I can love my neighbor too. "Mama, look at me," I shout, and she waves from the bench from under her favorite tree. When I'm out of breath, I sit at the edge of the sandbox watching the other kids play. A girl tosses me a shovel and a pail. Then we build the most elegant castle and dig a moat around it. We decorate it with royal flags made of sticks and seeds and leaves. "That was kind of that girl," Mama says when we're walking back home. I liked seeing how she loved her neighbor, and the neighbor this time was you. Sharing toys with a new friend is a way to show love. Maybe I can love my neighbor too. There's sand between my toes, and Mama says it's time for the tub. But then we hear a knock at the door. It's our neighbors from upstairs, and they baked us a loaf of bread. Sharing good things to eat is a way to show love. Maybe I can love my neighbor too. At dinner, I tell Daddy, "Guess what? I learned something new today." "That's what I like to hear," he says. "What is it?" "Every person in the whole world is my neighbor," I say, "and I can love them too." I could give my birthday money to someone who needs it more than me, I say. Or I could carry groceries or open doors for people who aren't as strong as I am. I pull up my sleeves and show my muscles. There are a lot of ways, I say. I can be kind to other kids in the park, or even bake something to share with people in our building. I knew you'd find ways to show love to others, Mama says with a smile. Every other person in the whole wide world is my neighbor, whether they live next door or across the street or far, far away. And I know I can love my neighbors too.
There were so many things in there that we can do to love our neighbors. What were some of the things that you heard? Maybe it was giving food to people who need it. Maybe it was holding doors open for people. And maybe it was even giving money to people who need it and who need our help. Those are all ways that we can love our neighbors, especially right now. No act of kindness is too great or too small, because all acts of love come from God. And God was here to care for and to help all people in need, no matter their skin color, their race, where they came from, or even how much money they have. God loves each one of us, and we need to show that love, especially right now, to people who are hurting. First step that I always like to do when I'm trying to think of ways that I can help is to pray. So can you pray with me today? Dear Lord, thank you for sending your son Jesus, for teaching us how to love. Thank you for sending so many people into our lives, our neighbors who live right next door to us, across the street from us, and maybe even a few states and countries away from us. We love all of these neighbors, and we hope and pray that we can show that love to everyone that we meet, no matter their skin color, their place of living, or how much money that they have. Help us to be better neighbors each and every day, and challenge us to go out of our comfort zones in order to help even more people that may need that love and care and kindness. In your awesome and wonderful name we pray. And all God's children said, Amen.
This is the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy, and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. And children will rise up against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Backlash. It's a doozy of a scripture. The words coming to us in the Gospel of Matthew this morning. Jesus calls his disciples. He looks out and has compassion on crowds being harassed, helpless crowds. And having compassion on them, Jesus sends out 12 of his disciples out into the crowds, and not only to the crowds, but out into the cities of Israel, to go and to bring power, to multiply the effects of his own ministry. As he sends them out, he commissions them and gives them authority. Gives them authority to do the things that he was doing. He gives them authority to announce the coming of the kingdom of heaven. And in that coming, in that announcement, he also gives them power. Power to cast out demons. Power over the unclean spirits in people's hearts and bodies. Power to heal the sick. Power to raise the dead. Now, with that explosion of power, an explosion of miraculous power that often I hear people today yearning for, saying, if only we could heal the sick, if only we could raise the dead, if only we could cast out demons, then people would really be able to get a handle on the power of God, a handle on the power of Jesus. And people would have faith, and people would listen, and their hearts would turn to God, and the world would be transformed. Well, these disciples had that power. Those 12 disciples were commissioned by Jesus, given Jesus' power, and sent out into the countryside to proclaim and to heal and to cast out demons, to bring wholeness to people wherever they came. But Jesus didn't only give them power. He also sent them out with a warning. He said, "Beware. Beware," Jesus says. "They will harass you. They will capture you. They will flog you in their holy places. They will drag you before government. They will accuse you. People will be so stirred up against you that they would even be willing to participate in your death." Elsewhere, Jesus says, "That's how they treat me. That's how you will be treated." And we know how they treat Jesus. This man who brings an offer of healing, this man who announces the coming of the kingdom, this man who proclaims the wholeness to every single person that he meets. They respond with crucifixion, condemnation, and death. It's quite the backlash to a message of hope and healing and love. It's so outrageous of a backlash, it's almost hard to imagine, and yet, well, and yet maybe not so hard. We see backlash in our own lives. A man named Trooper tells a story. He's a gay black man. He tells a story about a place where he used to work, with a boss that he used to work for. He had a boss who was a white woman, and who, in the course of her work, in the course of supervising him and guiding him and being his boss, he would ask her, or she would ask him, "How are you doing, Trooper?" And he would say, I'm fine." But she would keep asking. She'd keep pressuring him to go deeper. "Now, how are you really doing?" she would ask. "I want to know. How are you really feeling here? I'm an ally. You can trust me," she said. Well, he never really told people how he really felt. He didn't really feel like white people really wanted to know how black people felt. And so usually he didn't say much, but after asking and after pressuring him and after proclaiming herself an ally, he trusted her with his true feelings. He shared what was on his mind. Trooper shared how he felt that some of the structures of the workplace had underlying homophobia built in. He had experienced discrimination. He shared that honestly. And he shared honestly, it didn't make him feel very good. He made sure to let her know that it wasn't something that she did, that it was the structure, and that it wasn't her fault. There were ways that the structure was homophobic. Now, his boss, she was outraged at this. She was upset that he was experiencing homophobia. She said, "Well, I'm super against homophobia. I really, really am bothered by this." And she even got so upset in their meeting together that she began crying. And Trooper, well, he spent the rest of the time together consoling her because she was so upset that there was homophobia in the system. The next week, things changed for the worse. Trooper's boss decided after that meeting, after that discomfort, that no, there wasn't homophobia in the structures here. The structure was not homophobic. The incidents that Trooper had experienced, that he had mentioned, they were isolated incidents. The problem wasn't systematic. And instead, Trooper became the problem. Because he had shared his true feelings. He had said something that made her feel bad. Made her feel uncomfortable. And he ended up being pushed out of that job. The only job in his entire life where he had actually opened up and shared how he really felt. Shared it with a boss who had asked him to, pressured him to, proclaimed herself an ally, offered support, but then found herself so discomforted by what he said, so discomforted by his experience of the structures in which they worked, that her response was backlash and retrenchment back into what was comfortable. It's easier to push the reality away than to wrestle with the discomfort, the dehumanization of others. The backlash is real. Friends, when Jesus sends his apostles out healing, he sends them out into a world where people profit off of the sickness and the brokenness of others. He sends them out to a system and a society that profits off of having a huge amount of people that are hurting, that are sick, that do not matter. And as he sends them out with a message to heal, to lift up, to cast out demons. And that's the real problem. Once demons start getting cast out, once people start being offered wholeness, once people start to hear that their lives matter, once they understand the full humanness of themselves, and once that reality begins to work and to change the system, well, the status quo, the way as it always has been, gets upset. It gets uncomfortable. Chaos is preferable to actually changing. So much chaos is preferable that people would actually participate in the demise of family members. Dear people, for too long, the systems of racism and homophobia and sexism, those demons have been allowed to possess our society for too long. We have been unwilling participants in the demise of our fellow human family members for too long. And now, in these weeks, when the world seems to be waking up to the pain of people and the full humanness of individuals of all races, of all sexualities, of all genders, well, it can be overwhelming. It can be overwhelming to see all of this. All this pain, all this hurt, and to try to fathom that it's been going on for so, so long. It can be so overwhelming, but we cannot let it overwhelm us. Jesus knew that his disciples would face overwhelming odds, and he knew that they could not be overwhelmed if the kingdom was to truly take root and flourish and grow in the world and come as it was proclaimed to come. And so he gave them instructions for how they were to go out, to face all those struggles, all that chaos, all that backlash that was going to come. He sent them out prepared, wise as serpents, innocent as doves. And how did he prepare them? He told them, take no thing with you. Do not take your defenses. Do not take another set of clothes. Don't take another set of sandals. Don't take a walking stick. Don't take a bag. Don't take a coin purse with any coins in it. Take no money, no extra gear. Just go out with nothing. With nothing, Jesus sends them out. And there's so much wisdom in that. I cannot help but wonder what would have happened that night at the third precinct, the day after George Floyd's death, if the police officers had left their building with nothing and had not met the protesters with riot shields and tear gas, but instead with open hands and tears and voices that were ready to join the cries of outrage at the death of yet another black man. When you're armed with nothing but a broken heart and a contrite spirit, as Psalm 51 tells us to be armed with, when all your defenses are gone, well, then there's nothing left to overwhelm you because you've given it all up already. And you have already been overwhelmed by the loving power of the Most High God. Discomfort, even suffering, isn't something you feel the need to retreat from. Not then. Then you would even boast in it, as Paul says in Romans. After all this, I would even boast in my sufferings, because suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint because of the power of the Holy Spirit, because it's in our weakness that Christ really goes to work. So let us resist the backlash. Let us resist the lure of re-entrenching. Let us open ourselves to the pain of one another and to the full humanity of every single child of God under the sun. And with nothing in our hands, let us go out, and in that weakness, let Christ go to work. Amen.
Is it all, Lord? are the Lord of snow and rain. I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. By the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I
invite you to join me in proclaiming the story of our faith, which we will proclaim today through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now is the time in our worship where we get to celebrate God's love and abundant grace through the sharing of our tithes and our offerings. You can give today through texting on your mobile phone. You can text the word GIVE to 320-313-1815. You can also give today by mailing a check to the church, or you can give online at our website, www.ctkb.org/generosity. We thank you for your generosity in this continued time and for the way that you make our ministry possible, not only through your financial gifts, but through the gift of yourself, of your time, and of the talents that you have and that you share.
Thank you.
called into unity with one another and the whole creation, let us join together to pray for the church, the nations, and for all who are in need, responding to each petition with the words, "Graciously hear our prayer." O God, the Holy One of blessing, send your spirit of tender might throughout your church and to all its leaders, especially Bishop Eaton. Strengthen the believers who cannot assemble for worship. Guide the church's use of technology and make yourself known to those who have no access to such materials. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, the Holy One of truth, we pray for your spirit on teachers, preachers, and missionaries, especially those in South Africa, and Reverend Dorcas Wang in China, the Peace Center for the Blind in Jerusalem, Global Health Ministries, and those in Bloomington. Empower the church as it uses both historic and innovative words to proclaim your gospel across the street and around the globe. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, Holy One of creation, continue your care for the earth. Where there was fire or flooding, insect plagues or environmental destruction, drought or storm, bring renewal of the water, air, and land. Bless farmers and ranchers and protect the migrant workers as they toil in the sun to harvest our food. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, Holy One of unity, as we commemorate this week the martyrdom of the Emmanuel Nine, who in 2015 were killed while assembled in their Charleston church for Bible study, we pray, end the scourge of racism and white supremacy. Protect protesters. Halt those who intend violence. Preserve and strengthen our democracy. Raise up leaders who model repentance and reconciliation and support legislators who seek justice in our land. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, Holy One of compassion, heal the sick and embrace the fearful. Visit the millions who are suffering from the coronavirus. Protect us from another wave of disease. Uphold healthcare workers and medical researchers as they work on our behalf. Assist the unemployed to find a job. Show us how to provide safe housing and daily food for the homeless and hungry in our nation and around the world. We pray also for those we name here, Lori, Lois, Steve, Jim, Christine, Jaden, Pastor Dave, Char, Miriam, Stacy, John, Janet, Laura, Tom, Sadie, Jim, Cindy, and Donna. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, Holy One of hope, sustain those who cannot endure their suffering but are led only to despair. Pour your love and grace into their hearts. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, Holy One of mercy, we pray also for ourselves. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. O God, Eternal One, we praise you for the lives of all the faithful departed, both the famous and the forgotten, especially Bill, Joan, George, and Sig. Surround your families with your hope, and at the end of all things, bring to yourself all your treasured people to abide in your presence forever. Your steadfast love is everlasting. Graciously hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those desires too deep for words through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
I invite you to pray with me the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Okay, take two.
Blessings today, again, with the words of St. Francis. May God bless you with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and turn their pain to joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world, so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all, you are blessed. Amen.